morning, good afternoon, or good evening. I'm Audrey Wiggins, and welcome to another webisode of Make Something Happen. This is a bonus day for me. I have Henry Ford in the studio. No, he's not related to the automaker, but he is a great person indeed. Henry is a public speaker. Met him years ago when the group of us were into speaking and learning and the Les Browns and that whole crowd there. So, but Henry is a magna cum laude graduate, and his degree is in business and communications from Capital University. He is following his passion in his second career, and we're going to ask him about his first career in a moment, as an author, speaker, consultant, and publisher. He inspires audiences through his personal stories, historical references, and insightful vision, delivering his messages from the heart using the podium and the pen and the web. He encourages us to create and be the change we wish to be. Henry, give us a little more background, a little more meat about what I've just said about you. And again, thank you for being on the show today.
Well, you're very welcome, Audrey. It's really a pleasure to be on this program. As you mentioned, I'm an author, speaker. I've traveled around the world.
Yes.
I've done some consulting. And the first 45 years of my life, going back to my previous career, I was a computer programmer and systems analyst for 36 years.
Wow.
30 years with the company and then 6 years as a consultant.
Mm-hmm.
And so I sat in a booth in the back in the corner in the dark. And I didn't have any aspirations to be a public speaker.
Mm-hmm.
Somehow I got into writing, and many years ago, in fact, I was asked to introduce someone at a conference, and it was a small classroom type setting. And I was so nervous about public speaking at that time that I told the person that asked me, I said, I just told him, not me. I said it would take Jesus to get a microphone in my hand. And so as you see, where you are at a particular point in your life has nothing to do with where you can go.
Absolutely.
Where you might go. So what I believe and what I try to share with other people is that you have to keep an open mind. You need to keep up with technology. You need to think in terms of where you can go from where you're at. There are no limits to that.
I know you've got some projects. I'll be working on my vision or something.
I do have projects.
You have several.
Right.
Probably more than you sent me here on this report.
Well, Vision's newsletter is a newsletter that I put out every other month. Mm-hmm. And what I try to do in Vision's is to promote people, expose people to positive news with news from people that are doing things, mm-hmm. particularly young people.
Okay.
Our last issue, we're normally 8 pages long. Our last issue was so filled with positive stories that it ended up being 12 pages.
Oh, that's great.
And while normally I'm begging people, please send me some positive news, I wanted to say, you know, you can slow down a little bit.
That's a good problem to have.
But we featured people in our last issue, such as Taylor Greene, who's an author, 18-year-old author, wrote a book entitled 365 Ways to Succeed.
Wow.
And what I like about Taylor and many of the other people that we feature is that not only do they have a lot going for them, they're positive, they are so grateful.
Okay.
Taylor couldn't stop saying thank you. She just couldn't believe the support she was receiving
awesome.
From me.
Mm-hmm.
And I tried to explain to her that I was so inspired by her example.
Mm-hmm.
Doing things at 18 that I didn't think to begin until I was 50.
Right.
That I am empowered and encouraged to get up every day and mm-hmm. share with others stories like hers.
Mm-hmm.
That keeps me going. So
absolutely.
In a way, you can say I have an 18-year-old mentor.
That's also about, I like that kind of put the script. And then again, that speaks to transition and going on to the next thing. And you know, if that person is there, that mentor, she's an awesome young woman.
Yes.
I'd like to get a conversation with her one day. That would be great. And you have also something else. First, before I say that, though, your newsletter, it's electronic.
The newsletter is electronic. Okay. I have a few subscribers, but mm-hmm. I encourage people. I want the positive news to get out there. I like to say Visions is an alternative to the 6 o'clock news.
Okay.
Which
yes.
is also the 7 o'clock news and the 11 o'clock news, and then you'll hear it again the next day at 6 a.m.
Right.
and I have no qualms about news or news people, but we mm-hmm. need to infuse into our community, into our minds and our hearts,
yes,
some positive things about what people are doing. And I think that way it raises the bar. We will begin to set new standards when we understand that we can't sink to the level of the lowest common denominator.
That's right. That's right. And along with that, Henry Reed, daily you put out some words of inspiration.
Oh, I almost forgot about that.
I enjoy receiving those every day in my email and you know, Facebook.
Right. I share daily inspirations, mm-hmm. which used to be a collection of quotes from other people. And mm-hmm. what I started doing about a month ago is I started to take quotes and information out of my first book, which is Success Is You.
All right.
The book is currently out of print, but what I found is that I need to share who I'm about in addition to, because you can go out and you can get quotes mm-hmm. from Google, and I'm not against sharing those quotes. I think many of them are powerful.
Oh, they yes.
enhance my life.
Yes.
But what I also want to do is people that did not get Success As You, I've had good reviews on it.
Mm-hmm.
I want to share what I'm about. So what I've done the last approximately 30 days is I've taken selected excerpts out of Success As You and shared those that are not too long for a simple read.
Right, right. Want to share some with us now?
I could.
Yeah. Yes, absolutely.
I don't think.
Any plans to reprint the book, put it back in print?
One of my mentors is insisting that I publish another issue, another version of Success
yes.
As You.
Yes, I think a 21st century edition is definitely in order.
I thought that maybe this might do it, but here's an example,
okay.
And I haven't read this completely through, so
mm-hmm.
You are the band leader of your own parade. Until you sound your own trumpet, there will be no music to march to. You have to decide whether your reward will be the acceptance by members of the small world, or the reward and self-fulfillment and self-actualization of success from members of the big world. This
oh, wow.
is in the chapter entitled Laying the Foundation, which is
great
early
place.
In the book.
Okay. Great place to start. Thanks for sharing that. Any advice? Because you've had a long career, but I would consider successful. You know, your career has been successful. And the type of people that you've had to work with, that you've mentored, or perhaps you know, that they have mentored you throughout the years. What would you say would have been the most inspiring moment? Or maybe there's a few.
There are a few inspiring moments, but I'll give you one example of why when you decide on your dream and you work toward it, sometime you continue the process of sharing what you have to share regardless of what the short-term outlook is.
Okay.
And one example is I was on a cruise in the Panama Canal and I spoke on board ship. And there were about 60 people in attendance. And back in Acapulco, where we had to fly back to the United States, a lady approached me and she said, I was in your audience on the cruise ship. You don't know me because I didn't make myself known. She said, but I hope you don't mind second place. And I'm thinking, well, as long as there were more than two people in the race. But what she said was,
you know, great sense of humor.
I'm wondering, second place for what? She said, her most rewarding experience in that cruise was going through the Panama Canal. She said, my speech was next.
That's awesome.
I said, okay.
Phenomenal.
And then she said something that I still don't quite understand, but I just accept.
Mm-hmm.
She said, I'm a breast cancer survivor and a lung cancer survivor.
Wow.
And what you said really inspired me. And so I tried not to look puzzled.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't mention breast cancer. I didn't mention lung cancer. I didn't mention anything medical. The extent of my medical background is to take two aspirin and call somebody else in the morning.
Absolutely.
And it occurred to me, something occurred to me that Les Brown said. He said, sometimes the why is none of your business.
Absolutely.
He said, you just go out into the world and you do what you do and you do it the best you can. Mm-hmm. He said, and it will touch people and it will change people. So from that lesson, it was inspiring. It also taught me, don't try to tailor my message to a particular person or a situation.
Okay.
Share what I believe I have to share. Mm-hmm. And it will touch the people that it should touch.
Hi, I'm Dr. Howard Cohn, and I'm here to tell you about the key to alkalizing your body, and that's our 7.2 greens. This product is amazing. You'll never find anything else like it on the market. This thing has taken so much time to put together to get it exactly the way we want it so that you can literally eat it out of your hand, out of the container. Most people know that if they eat greens, they're going to be healthier. They start doing it, they do it for a day or two, they try wheatgrass or they try eating spinach or broccoli, and they go, you know what? I can't do this. It tastes like I'm licking the bottom of my lawnmower. And they stop. They know it's good, but they stop and they don't do it. We've engineered these greens to taste amazing. I can't wait for you to try them. Our 7.2 greens are made with all organic ingredients. Certified organic ingredients are cereal grasses, which are barley grass, oat grass, alfalfa, and wheatgrass, all organic. Our alkalizing vegetables of parsley, broccoli, broccoli sprouts, spinach, kale, cabbage, carrot, and more, all organic. Our flavoring, which is apple and raspberry, organic. And even our Lohan berry, all natural sweetener. No algaes, no soy fillers, no artificial flavors, no colors, no sweeteners. There is nothing on the market like this. I've tried literally hundreds of greens products, all a disappointment. I've had tons of patients say they can't do it. For the first time ever, we have a greens product that people will not only take, but they'll love. I can't.
We're back now with Henry Ford. Henry, there are several things that you've been doing. Thanks again for sharing from your first book, Successes You. I'm definitely looking forward to that that next edition, that second edition for the 21st century. Okay, just want to give that. You have another book with you and some other organizations that you're involved in. Let's just share with our audience what's going on, you know, within those areas and how we can be inspired, empowered, and, you know, to really make a difference in our lives, which puts us in a position, really, to make a difference in someone else's life, you know, how we need to grow in the different areas.
Okay, well, in The Power of Association, mm-hmm. which was my second book, I talked about my experience in NAIC, which is the National Association of Investors Corporation.
Okay.
I did a lot of pioneering work during the late 1970s and early 1980s, mm-hmm. wherein I tried to share the investment education I was receiving by being involved in NAIC. I tried to get that shared and exposed in the black community. I had approached the chairperson of NAIC and commented to him that there's very little representation of African Americans at their annual conference, and I wanted him to do something about it as in a lot of publicity.
Yeah.
And he explained to me that they couldn't, as a nonprofit organization, focus their effort into one particular community, but being the chairperson, being smarter than I was, he involved me in the process. He told me that if I was able to find an organization or individual that expressed an interest in investment education, just send their name and contact information and he would forward them a package.
All right.
So I worked with NAIC in that capacity for over 10 years as a volunteer.
Mm-hmm.
And there were some moments that were challenging. I got a lot of no's. A lot of people looked at me like, why would I put my money into something called a stock certificate? Anyway, in 1987, I was awarded the Investment Education Award, and that was because I had created a breakthrough with a major publication, which was Black Enterprise Magazine.
Yes.
So now you very seldom pick up a copy of Black Enterprise Magazine where it's not a reference to investment.
That's right.
So that was a lesson in rewards. It was a lesson in persistence. I tried to share that same, not the same message, but I tried to use that inspiration working with the Black Data Processing Associates, BDPA.
Okay.
I spent many years, in fact, I'm still a member of that organization, and what we're trying to do at this time is to erase or at least eliminate some portions of that technology gap. Mm-hmm. And it's even more important now than it was many years ago when I started in BDPA, because the world is changing.
Yes.
At a much more rapid pace.
That's right, because of that technology.
Right, there are things that you just simply cannot do without. I went to file my state sales tax the other day and they said, you must file it electronically.
Mm-hmm.
So yes. our community needs organizations like NAIC, we need investment education, we need technology awareness. We need a lot of those things to close that gap that we're always talking about.
Yes.
Just being willing is not enough. You have to be empowered through knowledge and involvement.
Absolutely.
And in fact, the power of association, I wrote it prior to the organization that I'm now very active in, which is Eagles of Success.
Mm-hmm.
And what I like about that group, not only do they use the same techniques we use in sharing information, many of them, such as yourself, are speakers, authors, consultants, there's pastors.
Yes.
There are many people that are in the business of communicating, so they understand even more so than other groups how important it is for us to communicate with ourselves, with each other, to share our knowledge, because as Stephen Covey mentioned, in talking about synergism, one plus one, despite what we've been taught in math, equals three. When you start to take the knowledge and the experience and the inspiration and combine it with the knowledge and inspiration of another person, it becomes even more powerful.
Absolutely.
You start to generate ideas that neither of you would have come upon alone.
And that's that three. That's powerful.
Right.
Absolutely. And what if, share with our audience some more the principles, since we're talking about Eagles of Success, of that organization is built upon, and why it's helped us.
I believe one of the things is, of course, that connectedness, the willingness to want to work together, bringing something to the table without having great expectations. The great expectations are created out of the activity that takes place. The last, but of course not least, that I want to mention is Eagles of Success is a Christian-based organization.
Yes.
In my mind, that is an invaluable asset.
Mm-hmm.
It's not that being connected requires you to be a Christian, only Christians can connect, but my strong belief and my entire life is based on Christian principles. So,
yes.
In my house,
we will serve the Lord.
And I think I was drawn, the way I met the founder of Eagles of Success, despite my parents, we met in a barbershop.
Okay.
And at the time, I was doing some speaking, and he became aware of it, and he said, I'd like to be a speaker. And I hear this so often, I was willing to help and stay connected, but in the back of my mind was that, yeah, right.
Right, yeah, yes.
And so we touched base a few times, but I didn't jump head over heels to stay connected to Ken.
Mm-hmm.
And what happened is several years later, I got something in either mail or email that Ken was inviting me to something he was having at the Rainbow Bookstore.
That's where I met him.
And
amazing.
I went up there and I looked around, and here was a minister at the time, a public speaker.
Yes.
And he had an audience.
Uh-huh.
My first inclination was to get mad at him because his audience was bigger than mine. And then I realized, I said, this young man reached out to you.
Yes.
I said, twice.
Mm-hmm.
He reached out to you the first time and he needed help and advice, and you kind of talked to him, but then you didn't really follow through, and the two of you became separated. So he reached out to you again.
Mm-hmm.
And he's got a big audience here. I said, you better stay connected, because three strikes and you're out.
Absolutely.
So that's why I'm excited about the Eagles of Success.
Power of Association. Let's get a little deeper into that here.
Well, the Power of Association I wrote as a follow-up to my book, Success Is You, because Success Is You talked about the individual. It talked mm-hmm. about accountability. It talks about involvement. It talks about persistence. And all of this you can do as a single individual. In fact, only you can do it. Only you can change your own life in that respect. But what happens is there's a piece missing. When you have something to offer, and other people have things to offer, what the Power of Association does and tries to encourage is that you take your talents and your abilities and lend it to a power greater than your own, or not a power greater than your own, lend it to something bigger than yourself.
Okay.
In other words, there are needs here, and you don't have to be an author, you don't have to be a speaker, you don't have to have a particular occupational title. All you need to do is to recognize the need. There are needs out here in the areas of hunger, there are needs in education. Obviously, our political system needs some involvement. We may not need more politicians, but we need more voters.
Oh, yes.
There are many things that you can combine your efforts with other people by being a part of an organization. What it does for you, what I really like about the Power of Association, it gives you the opportunity to learn things that you would have to pay for as a college student, for example. I didn't know anything about marketing, or publicity, or membership until I got into BDPA.
Okay.
What I found is, as a volunteer, number one, I didn't have to fill out lengthy applications and go through political processes to become involved. Organizations are always in need of and looking for people that bring some strength to the table,
yes.
And more so than a strength, a willingness to participate.
Mm-hmm.
In fact, one of the things that shocked and surprised me, and I'm grateful for it, mm-hmm. is the people that I look up to as mentors. I had someone say that I was their mentor. Mm-hmm. I'm thinking, wait a minute,
mm-hmm.
but you're the one, I'm trying to learn from you. And they said, well, we learn from each other. So that's why I enjoy having an 18-year-old mentor. I didn't tell her she was my mentor yet. But I'm just hoping, because of the things that I've done in her behalf, that she will accept that role. And I'm not looking for her to pass me a paycheck or anything like that. But I want to continue to learn from her, because
yeah.
she is in touch with a generation that's current.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm not going to count myself out, but many times what people feel is that their age qualifies them to stop doing any and everything except sitting in rocking chairs.
Right.
I don't believe that. And so, since, regardless of what I believe, some of my generation think that way, I want to have some input and some connections to people of all generations.
Yes.
Because we all have something to bring to the table.
Absolutely.
And
definitely do.
That is the foundation, the basis for the Power of Association. And I'm glad to say that even though this book is probably over 15 years old now, I still go back to it and the concepts seem to remain true.
We'll be right back with Henry Ford.
We'll be right back.
career of speaking and training, what are some of the people that you've trained that you, you know, have gone on to do bigger, you know, greater things in your careers?
No. To quantify that.
Okay.
I'm not sure. I follow my family probably more closely.
Okay.
And the thing about trying to identify those people is that many times I'm kind of afraid to take the credit for what they've done.
Mm-hmm.
Because as a believer in the power of association and being involved at the level I'm involved in, I have found that people are a product of so many different inputs,
mm-hmm.
that I can't take the credit for any. I would like to say that there's a young lady in Twinsburg, Ohio. I didn't know she lived there. I met her many years ago. I didn't know she was in Twinsburg. She's been there about as long as I have.
Oh.
And we were communicating one day. She looked me up. She found me on Facebook. And she mentioned that she's a poet now. And she's written several books on poetry, and she said she was inspired by my book entitled Success Is You, which was given to her by her sister.
Awesome.
And I'm thinking, you mean somebody lives around the corner from me that's mm-hmm. inspired to have written two or three books on poetry, and I didn't even know they existed.
Wow.
So while I can't name a lot of names,
mm-hmm.
I know that the impact is there.
Yes.
Periodically, someone will come up and say, I know you. I heard you speak. A gentleman a few days ago, he heard me speak at the Huff Library back in the early 1990s.
Okay.
And I'm thinking, what did I say? I hope I'm acting like the message I delivered. So you never know. When you are at the podium and when you write,
okay.
very often you don't know the people that you impact, because most people will not give you the feedback, and occasionally they will.
Yes.
But the message I have to leave in response to that question is just continue to do what you do, mm-hmm. and do it in a way that if your mother's watching, you should be proud.
Okay.
It helps to have set in a workshop with Les Brown.
Okay.
And hear some of what he shares with you.
Mm-hmm.
He spoke one time, when you talk about influencing people, he spoke one time about how he was in Los Angeles, I believe, and he gave a presentation, but there were only four or five people there.
Okay.
So he didn't do his best.
Mm.
And there was a young man that called him at his hotel at 3 o'clock in the morning, and he talked to Les. He said, you didn't give us our best.
Wow.
And Les said, what do you want from me? Only four people showed up.
Mm-hmm.
And the young man kept badgering Les, and Les said, finally gave in and admitted he didn't do his best and agreed to do something over again. And Les said, from that lesson, what he learned is, if you only have one person in the room, he said, you talk to them until their ears bleed.
Wow.
Now, I wouldn't recommend that.
But the point being, you always give your best.
Always
right?
give your best.
Yes.
I did an adult education session. You're taking me back a long way.
Oh.
I did an adult education session in Twinsburg many years ago, and it was bad weather. Mm-hmm. And in addition, I found that the people who were promoting the workshop that I was given really didn't do their absolute best, because I had a friend call to register for the workshop, and they were told, we will let you know if it's not canceled.
Okay.
And I thought that was a strange remark coming from a system that was trying to get adult education people to sit in those seats.
Right.
We'll call you if it's not canceled. So they were expecting a cancellation.
Mm.
Well, sure enough, and I don't know the reason for this, I'm not going to speculate.
Right.
Sure enough, I received a call on the day of the event, and it was the school system that I had signed up with. And they told me that there was only three people registered, and so they wouldn't be able to pay me. the agreed upon fee. And I said, it doesn't matter. Because if three people want to hear what I have to say, that's three more than many people will have, a larger audience than most people would have. So what I did, I went in, I delivered my 1.5 hour session on adult education, on motivation, to three people.
All right.
And a year later, a lady approached me in the line at Giant Eagle. I still do my own shopping because my class wasn't full, so I didn't make a lot of money. But she approached me and she told me how much better things were. She reminded me she was in my session. And I thought, she may have been the reason that I said, I'll do it for nothing, because I wasn't going to turn those three people down for
the
lack of the $25 or $30 that I was supposed to make.
I know exactly what you're saying.
So I changed a life, and who knows, I don't know where she is at this time, but the chances are she may have referred me or my name, or she may find me 10 years from now and still be grateful.
Yes.
So that's the impact that we need to have. That's the position we need to take, is that we're going to do what we're going to do, and somebody is going to buy into it, and somebody's not.
Right.
Somebody's going to be critical of it, and that's all part of the game. The only way you cannot be criticized is, I was going to say not do anything, but you would be criticized for that also.
Absolutely, and then you would probably have regrets as well. And I love that story, how it ended, because you're talking about giving your best. And you gave your best with a choice to go and not receive a fee. And to me, that speaks to you living whatever your purpose is. And if your purpose was to inspire and empower somebody in that particular subject area, that's your job, whether you're getting paid for it or not. And I'm not advocating, going out, doing everything for free, because we do have to make a living, we do have to take care of ourselves, that's a given. But there are going to be times when it's not going to be the ideal situation, but you have to say, okay, why am I really in this? Am I in it for the money, or am I in it to help somebody and the money is going to follow?
Right. I left a fairly lucrative career before I needed to. The signs were there that things, or there was trouble on the horizon, but I was making pretty good money as a consultant in information systems. But after 36 years, if you're not a multimillionaire or you're not at that level that you think you should be regarding money, you're probably not going to get there. Apparently, you don't love what you're doing enough to have found that utopia that many people talk about. And because I was fortunate to have a retirement plan, Social Security, and some other things, I decided that I want to do what I want to do.
Yes.
Tomorrow is not promised to any of us, and it's just really sad that people go through their life always working for tomorrow and always looking for greater expectations, when there's a gentleman by the name of Cromwell, I believe, that wrote about Acres of Diamonds. And
I haven't heard that title in a while.
Don't date yourself. You're too young for all of this.
I know, let me
say, I know, somebody told you.
Somebody told me.
I'm sure. But in Acres of Diamonds, Cromwell talks about the valuable things that we have in the here and now, and sometime right next door. We ourselves are valuable because we were made by a higher power.
Yes.
Other people have that same value. And until and unless we realize the value in ourselves and the value in others, we can't capitalize on the riches of the world. Because we are the riches of the world. Without our health, there's nothing.
Yes.
So the best way I know to stay healthy is to continue to do what I do and to wake up in the morning, have a reason to get up and get started.
Absolutely.
My biggest problem now is if I wake up after 4:30 in the morning, I've got so many exciting things on my mind that I can't get back to sleep very often. And so my biggest challenge, one that I hope someone can help me with, is how to get that anywhere close to that 8 hours of sleep that people talk about.
Six for me.
Okay, well, I'll settle for that some days.
That's awesome. This is a great taste of pickle. Take a break, and we'll be right back with Henry Ford. Very inspiring. Thank you. Back now with Henry Ford. Henry has given us an inspiring story and advice. Henry, who was your mentor?
I would have to say, I didn't realize at the time that he was a mentor, but Bertram Gardner, who was formerly director of several Y's in Cleveland, and he was also served as community relations director under Mayor Locher and Mayor Stokes.
Okay.
And he was vice president at, I believe it was Ameritrust at the time. He was a mentor in that he took me in under his wing, and he didn't give a lot of advice, but it was always powerful. It was more the way he lived his life.
Okay.
That the reason I called him a mentor.
Mm-hmm.
One of the things he did was that was notable back in 1963, I believe, I was looking for a job, and he gave me a job at the Y doing some clerical work,
okay.
The Glengo Y.
Wow.
And I didn't realize at the time, I found out later, he gave me this job doing clerical work. He formerly had a volunteer doing that same work. He only gave it to me. It didn't pay a lot, but it was enough to encourage me. So he used the discretion that he had to pay me for something he could have gotten for free.
Okay.
So that stuck with me, and I think that's one of the reasons when I give service now, I think in terms of, you know, what kind of a person is developing or what kind of person will I develop out of this experience as opposed to will I receive $5 or $10 or $15.
Mm-hmm.
So Bertram was a very powerful mentor, and of course now I have multiple mentors.
Yeah, absolutely.
And multiple
blessed. Known and unknown. Yes, absolutely. So what would your advice be then for the person coming along now, young or middle-aged or whatever, you know, for career change, there'll be a transition, I guess, from an older person and or a more mature person, or the young person who wants to say, like, break in on the scene, you know, everyone wants to be a public speaker or a coach or something like that, they want to write books. And just an overall, your advice for us?
Well, first of all, I think you have to have an open mind to learning.
Mm-hmm.
Recognize your strengths, and don't be afraid to participate at the level that you're comfortable with. If you feel like you have great strengths in writing, then write and share. If you think your strengths are in speaking, speak, but whatever you do, share and be open to advice from other people that are in the field that you think you want to become a part of. Realizing that during your career, during your lifetime, what's going to happen, what is likely to happen, is that you may make several changes in direction in your career. But the thing that is important is you keep the focus on having integrity, serving others and being true to yourself. And you have to be around positive people. There is a saying, and it may sound trite, but you cannot soar like an eagle if you're surrounded by turkeys.
All right.
And this is why I like the Eagles of Success, not just in name, but in action. They
yes.
live out that philosophy. And that's the other thing, is Eagles of Success, we are not just out there actively looking for people, but an organization like ours, if you come, bring something to the table, bring your aspirations, your goals, your talents, it's a very powerful group. I would recommend that anybody that is considering, and you don't have to be changing careers, you might be just stuck in your career. You may be searching, not know where you want to go. The thing is, main thing is you're being around positive people. And you have to let your detractors go. You have to ignore them. That's the best advice I can give people, is remain open to learning, keep a positive attitude, share yourself, and you'll be fine.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, here we want to thank you again for your time you spent with us today here on Make Something Happen. And I just want to encourage all of you out there, Tom, to take the advice which Henry gave us today and go out and make something positive happen in your world today. Thank you.
Thank you for having me.
Absolutely.